If you'd have told me 20 years ago that you'll still be doing it that long into the future, I'd have been buzzing. I feel old, obviously, firstly, because I don't really feel old day to day. You know, it's only when people say things like that or, you know, the fact I've got a teenage son and stuff like that, you know, when you stop to think about things. But I'm immensely proud of our longevity to still be doing it. If you'd have told me 20 years ago that you'll still be doing it that long into the future, I'd have been buzzing, because I think to do it for that length of time, you must be doing something right. It's not been plain sailing. You know, there's been bumps in the road. We've gone through things together and there's been some changes. But yeah, it's kind of wonderful. It's kind of wonderful to have that friendship and that kind of creative bond that we have. Five of us now. And yeah, I don't know what I'd do without it, you know. Bands are weird, you know. I guess it's odd to have a friendship that lasts that long in some ways, but to have friendship with work as well, I call it work, you know. It's unique to keep it going, and it's most bands don't get to do that for that length of time. So, but I think luck is helpful, and trust, and with us, it's just we're quite capable of being in a room together and not letting all the big things that go on in the world and the really serious things kind of dictate our kind of mood and dynamic too much, you know? It's like, we're quite just happy just making music and talking about films and football, you know? Even though we make kind of, you know, serious music, we keep the seriousness and the anxieties. For the most part, we keep that into the music rather than to the day-to-day pitter-patter of, you know, pitter-patter of chatter. I don't know what I'm trying to say. So we just kind of, guys that sit around and I don't know, are quite comfortable in just doing that, really. Well, we at that time to pay the bills, I was working in a call center with Russell, so we met studying together at university, and when that finished, we all moved to Birmingham and rented a place, and yeah, we worked day jobs. Ed and Chris worked in a shoe shop. Me and Russell worked in a call center for a bank, and we rehearsed in the evening. And there came a time when there's, you know, we were just too busy to, you know, keep picking up the phones and getting in a transit van, doing those first little tours. And, you know, the first song we put out was Bullets. No, you don't need this disease. Not right now. It got a little bit of traction, and there were people, you know, turning up to shows, and it became kind of a thing quite quickly from then. So I think that's perhaps one of the ultimate thrills, isn't it, to realize that you can't go back to work because your band is taking off. You know, there's something beautiful in that. I think it's further down the line that you realize what you have is perhaps building into something more, I don't know, just more of a machine, more substantial, that perhaps you might do for a long time. You know, around the time of the second record and traveling to places like the Netherlands and Europe and further afield, to feel it become, you know, not just small gigs all over the UK, but for there to be an audience in other parts of the world, was when you start to think, oh, actually what we're doing here is connecting and becoming significant. Well, I think the first there were a couple of things happened early on that felt, when things happen that become like little stories, they just become these little moments that, you know, document your, you know, just doing a gig. Do you know what I mean? The first time we ever left the UK to play was to go and do, London Calling Festival at Paradiso. So that was the first time we'd been on a ferry as a band to go and do a show. So obviously that was very exciting. I remember, I think it was the following summer that we were booked to play Lowlands, and our gear didn't turn up. So we had to borrow from other bands, quite a lot of Dutch bands actually.
We arrived in Amsterdam today, but all of our guitars and our gear stayed at the airport in England. So Viva Voce and Voiced lent us their stuff. So we'll do our best. But thank you to them. This is all because of them.
The story got out and the audience were more appreciative because of the fact we didn't cancel. We still did the show without our guitars and amplifiers, and that became a talking point. So things like that happen, you know, start to like permeate with, like you say, the Dutch people. And I think it becomes a bit special. You know, moving forward from them, why our music has continued to resonate and endure with you guys, I don't know. You have to ask someone who's Dutch, really. It's always been a pleasure. We've had some amazing shows, festivals, and experienced some incredible things along over those 20 years. So for us, it's just a joy, you know.
Vera on Track. Met Vera Siemons.